David Archer is back with me this morning from Savannah Resources. David, good to see you again.
Good morning, Andrew.
You've submitted the EIA and the mine plan this morning or recently for Mina de Barroso, so a significant milestone for Savannah.
Yeah, it's a major point in the development of the project, and one which we're sort of very proud of, because we think it presents a very transparent picture of what we're looking to deliver at Mina de Barroso, and particularly sort of emphasises the fact that, you know, we're really looking at proposing a very responsible and sustainable project that will have, you know, profound socio-economic and demographic benefits for the region and for the local community. So we're very pleased with it. It's a very major work. It's taken us something like 18 months to pull it together. It's over 6,000 pages in length, I think something like 5 to 6 times the size of War and Peace. We involve something like 28 sub-consultants and subject matter specialists, and it was led by an independent and very expert Portuguese environmental consulting group called Visa. We had 18 baseline studies that went to support it. And I think the key thing is that I think it really sort of provides a platform of fact-based information that will sort of allow an informed dialogue to occur, you know, both with the government and of course with stakeholders as well.
So what's the process from here then, given it's been submitted?
Yeah, well, it's been submitted to the Portuguese environmental regulator, APA, and at the same time to the mines department in Portugal. So they'll be undertaking an initial review, and that's really more around the lines of, you know, does it comply with the lodgement requirements of APA. So that will take a number of weeks to do that. And once APA acknowledges that it is in compliance with their requirements, the document will be released for public exhibition. And really that'll sort of kickstart a very sort of comprehensive and active round of engagement with the local communities and stakeholders. So we're sort of mapping out a detailed sort of multi-meeting approach to introducing some of the sort of the key features and key outcomes from the EIA to the communities in coming months.
And you'd be expecting good local support for the project?
We sort of think that, you know, we present a pretty sort of compelling sort of picture around what the project will mean, in that it will be a low impact project. It'll minimise the disturbance to, you know, both the natural community, natural environment, and local communities. And I believe that the local community and local stakeholders have really been looking forward to sort of seeing this study, because, you know, this will provide them with, you know, sort of clearly a massive information to evaluate. But importantly, you know, it's fact based, it's science based, it's based around the conclusions of subject matter specialists, and it sort of really eliminates, you know, perhaps some of any misconceptions, misunderstandings, or sort of requirements for information that people have had. I think actually the document itself will really sort of raise the bar in terms of you know, the quality and that's the depth of EIAs that will be sort of sought from future applicants for mining lease applications.
And it's typically about a 7-month period for you to wait to hear back, is it?
Something like 7 to 10 months, depending upon how many sort of feedback from APA they may require further information in sort of certain areas. We'll have to collect that, collate it, and submit that to APA. But, you know, somewhere between 7 to 10 months is the sort of licensing period.
And what can you get on with in the meantime while you're waiting to hear back?
Well, on top of the stakeholder engagement, the good news is that a lot of the work that really went into the EIA and MP can very sort of comfortably sort of be folded into the definitive feasibility study, which we will be starting off, not starting off, but incorporate layering that in over the next couple of months. But the MP, you know, provided some really sort of vital evidence that really was needed to sort of frame the DFS. You know, it's around sort of detailed design, the layout. The site itself is a little bit sort of challenging in terms of boundaries. So there was a lot of work that had to go into actually sort of shaping the infrastructure layout to sort of fit within the boundaries of the mining lease. There's a lot of information that comes out of the MP on the pit and plant design, scheduling and production rates. In fact, we're looking at a slight increase in the production rate to around about 175,000 tonnes of spodumene concentrate per annum. So a lot of this has been sort of iterative, but it'll mesh very nicely with the DFS.
Have you set a target time frame for when you'd like to have the DFS out?
Well, certainly towards the end of the year, and obviously, you know, some of the sort of feedback from the EIA will also have to be sort of folded into the DFS. But you know, we're sort of seeing increasing interest and push, particularly by the European Commission for the development of the electric vehicle industry in Europe. We think this is very much the right project at the right time, and it's a project that really can provide very sort of solid foundations for the development of both European and Portuguese industry.
And you've moved fairly quickly to get to this point as far as the project's development, haven't you?
Yeah, sort of traditionally it takes some time to take projects from first drill hole all the way through into production. We kicked off the project in mid 2017, and I'm pleased to say that we set a blistering pace of resource evaluation and have produced what is the sort of largest deposit of spodumene lithium in Europe, and a very, very sort of valuable resource for Portugal, and one that can sort of drive real sort of prosperity for the country.
Well, a big morning for you, David. Nice to see you. Thanks for the update.
Okay, great pleasure, Andrew.